church. We appreciate y'all being here this morning. Let us begin our time with prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord God, for your grace, for your mercy, and for your love, Lord. We thank you, Father God, for this beautiful day. Lord, we know that the seasons are changing. Father God, we pray, Lord God, that your spirit will blow through us, Father God, and change us also, to see your newness, to see your greatness, to see your love, Lord. As we gather together, we pray that your spirit bind us with love and your grace. Father, make us one people of one mind and one accord, that we can worship you with everything we are and everything we have. We thank you again for your love and your grace, Lord, for your son Jesus and the power of the Holy Spirit that brings us together in salvation and love. We pray, Lord God, that you help us, that you let us see you and hear you today. In Jesus' name, amen. Good morning.
Good morning.
Hope everybody's doing fine this wonderful morning. We thank y'all for being here. We want to remind everybody that we are beginning our men's breakfast again. So that will be next week at 7:30 here at the church. And we invite everybody to come and be a part of that. We're also looking forward to the end of the month. We want to remind everybody that we're having on Palm Sunday, the 28th, we are having our annual egg hunt and lunch to follow our services. We ask you to bring a prepackaged eggs so we can pass off to the kids. And if you want to be a part of helping with the lunch, please talk to Miss Dana for that purpose. And also, the following week is going to be Easter. And we're going back to our regular services, so we will have sunrise at 7, breakfast to follow, and then our service at 9 o'clock. Also, if you would like to be a part of that breakfast, please talk to Miss Dana for that also. All right, and then looking forward to May 30th to June 1st, we'll have our VBS here at the church, and it's going to be from 9 to 12. And if you want any information on either how to help or what's going on, please talk to Erica Burns on that, and then we'll get that going. Are there any other announcements that I have missed? Okay. If you take your hymnal, stand if you're ready. We're going to page 701. 701.
And his grace in love.
or do our affirmation of faith. 881. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sit at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Praise God for what he's doing in our life and life of others and share with each other. Does anybody have a praise?
So, Friday night, Springfield Methodist youth put on something at the Tabernacle, a worship service. It was nice to kind of see other people and kind of get back to normal a little bit.
Amen. I got to praise this beautiful road we got here today.
Yeah. Yeah.
Pastor Jose, did we introduce our very special guest yet?
Yes. No, we have not. Well, go ahead. You can do that.
This is our DS. Isn't that a blessing today?
Amen.
David Thompson is our district superintendent, so if you have anything you'd like to say to your band or a different, he's the guy.
Give me a break.
And there's always a method to his madness, so he can observe Jose today, and he can talk with you if you have anything that you'd like to say to him about the Methodist Church, about Mizma Church, he has the news. So thank you for coming. We appreciate it very much.
Thank you. Glad to be with you all very much. So.
Thank you. Take it easy. You had a long trip this morning.
Last week I asked that we put Dwayne Hughes on the prayer list. He had 7 skin cancers removed and is doing well.
Amen.
Jose, my grandson actually spends a lot of time with us, and this is funny to me, but only to those of you that are my age or older. I said, Ashley, put that in the icebox. He come back in a few minutes, and he looked at me perplexed. He says, Grandma, what's an icebox? My praise is that I'm old enough, but yet young enough to tell him what an icebox is.
Amen. Well, I want to tell you, talking about that really good-looking role there, he walks up and I talk to both of them. They're here to celebrate their upcoming birthday because, of course, they're living in different parts of the area. But Lorianne, I don't know if you guys saw it, Lorianne found a picture that we took with the youth at Easter in front of the thing there. It was years and years ago, and it was little. And they're about to be 25, so that's awesome. I'm with you. I'm old enough. I know what an icebox is, too. So.
She also put a picture of Sandy and Tommy on Facebook,
yeah.
And if y'all didn't see it, and you'd like to, I'm sure she'll show it to you. It was really nice to see them. They were looking at one another, smiling at one another.
They're having a really in-depth conversation. Yeah, it was nice. Yeah, praise God for that. All right, any others? All right, if you would turn to the back of your bulletin, you will see those names and situations we are praying for. Are there any that need to be added or can be removed? Just want to remind you, those names that are italicized will come off unless you tell us not to. Mayor Haney, isn't he be at it? Okay, let us go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord God, for your grace, your mercy, and for your love, Lord. We thank you for your Son, Jesus, and the power of the Holy Spirit, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, that you made a way through Jesus to you, Lord, that we can come, Father God, and rejoice and praise and be in thanksgiving, Lord God, for all your blessings, Lord, for your love and your grace that you give us. Father, we pray, Lord, we give you thanks. Thanks for everything. Thanks for the history we have together, Lord. Thanks for the love that we share. Thanks, Lord God, that we have a foundation not only in Jesus, Lord, but in each other. So we thank you, Lord God, for your many blessings and your many gifts and graces, Lord God, that you give us, and that we can see you working in our lives and the life of others. Father, but we also know that for every Thanksgiving we have, there is a need. So Lord, we pray for these names that we have on our list, those that we continue to have in our hearts and our minds, Lord God, and those in our community that we don't even know about, Father. The world is tough. There are tough times we are dealing with, Lord God, things that are coming at us that are strange and heavy, and we pray for them, Lord. We pray for every family. Lord, we pray for this community, Father God, and we pray for those that are out dealing with all these COVID things, Father God, and everything that comes with it. So we pray for them, Lord. We pray for strength. We pray for grace. We pray, Lord God, for resources that are needed. And Father God, we pray that you would continue to work in their lives. Heal the body, heal the mind, Lord God. Strengthen them and give them everything they need. And Father God, for us, Lord, we pray that you would open our eyes and ears to hear you and see you. And we can see where it is that you have us go and spread your love and your grace and your mercy. So we thank you again for all that you do. And we pray now that your Son taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. All right, if you take your hymnal, stand if you are able. We're going to 367, 367. You made the move, Father God, to redeem us, to love us, to touch us. Father God, we pray as we give today that that touch, that love that we receive from you, we can help others find that in your hands. In Jesus' name, amen. To the Gospel of Luke, chapter 9. We're going to start at verse 23, and it's page 1600 in our pew Bibles. Gospel of Luke, chapter 9. We're going to start at verse 23. Then he said to them all, "If anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. For what profit is to a man if he gains the whole world and is himself destroyed or lost?" We've been the last couple of weeks kind of talking about it, working our way to Easter. And this year I'm taking a different kind of a road to Easter. Usually it's about introspection and trying to figure out who we are and where we're at and trying to get closer to God. But with our attitude that we began this year of talking about pushing in closer to God, so some of the things that we've been talking about have been more about us doing, getting closer, trying to figure out how we can be able to get closer to God and in turn begin to open ourselves up even more, not only to Him, but to each other. And today I choose to talk about giving. Okay? We're going to talk about giving, where it stems from, and how we should give. Now, I know when I say giving, the first thing that you think about, especially since they're in the bulletin, is printed out today, the budget, right? That's the first thing you think about, is the budget. Oh, here we go. The pastor's going to talk about money, right?
Amen.
Amen. Says that there's a superintendent. But but it's not wholly about money. It is about money. I mean, it is about the giving. Right? You know, the church and the body of Christ still has to operate. We still have to turn on the lights and things of that nature. But I'm not solely talking about money. Okay? It's giving of ourselves. When we talk about giving, it's not just money. I mean, I know in our society, in our world, money is important.
But it's what's important to you. Okay? It can be time. It can be love. It can be grace. It can be forgiveness. Whatever you need to give so that you can get closer not only to God, but to other people. Right? To give in a way that is good not only for others, but to ourselves. Because I'm here to tell you, we can give, but the gift that we give can do nothing because of how we give it. There's terms that we use sometimes. There's a cheerful giver, right? You hear that. You need to be a cheerful giver, which is something that is kind of an oxymoron, right? Because when you give, you're supposed to be cheerful, but if you're giving too much, then of course it hurts, right? So it's a cheerful giver. And we also have heard, give until it stops hurting, right? We need to change it until give until it stops hurting. And but I think we need to change it even more. And we need to give because it's fun. Our giving of whatever it is that we give, money, time, whatever it may be, it needs to start inside our hearts with joy. Because of how we receive that gift first. And what gift am I talking about? Well, the gift of the cross. That's what I'm talking about. It stems from Jesus Christ giving to us first, right? And even though, yeah, the Bible tells us that God, Jesus had some hard times, you know, in Gethsemane, right? You know, and he was trying to pass it on, but he still received it, and he still climbed on that cross joyfully, and still forgave freely, right? Ask God to not let it, you know, because they don't know what they're doing. Let us move on. That free gift that Jesus gave us started with love. Love produces joy. I try to do my private time, and there's a song that I listen to when I'm in that time, and it's Mercy Me, and it's called Happy Dance. And in this song, it says that in the happy dance, our joy produces our dance. And our joy requires, and then of course it goes into a louder version, our joy requires our happy dancing. And it starts doing this thing. And in my head, I love the song. I mean, I love it because it's telling us the truth. The things we receive from Jesus, the things that we get from God every day should produce joy. And that joy should move us into releasing that gift that he gives us to other people. And our giving should stem from that joy. And our attitude has to change. And that's what we've been talking about the last couple of weeks. For us to get closer to God, for us to push in more, we have to begin to believe what God is telling us. We need to begin to produce the things that God is leading us to. And giving is one of them. You know, you might be one of those persons that don't like to open up their, their circles. You want to keep, you know, your thing. You don't want no people to come in and do all that stuff. You don't go out and venture and things of that nature. So the more we close ourselves off, the less we are able to influence other people with God's love. When we put a lot of value on the things that we have, and it could be money, it could be your time, it could be your people, it could be possessions, it could be your intellect, It could be their education. It doesn't matter. Whatever it is that you put a lot of value on, that when you reach in your pocket, and it could be 25 cents, that it hurts. It hurts to go, here you go. Because we put so much value on the things that the world tells us we're supposed to put value on, right? You know, it could be the way I look, you know, my weight, how many muscles I have, you know, how my hair looks, you know, whatever. It could be whatever. So when we get to the point where God's going to say, you need to give. Here you go, give. And you're like, oh, it hurts. We need to begin to see those things as things. One of the stuff in my family that I haven't gotten in trouble for is that a dollar is just a piece of paper to me. It's always been a piece of paper to me. I because of my life and my attitude, I know I can make another dollar. So I'm going to spend a dollar. And I'm going to spend a dollar on making me happy. And Jose is very happy. My wife isn't. And my back is happy now. But Jose is very happy. Because a dollar is a dollar. Right? You know, and that's me with the money, but it could be your time. Time is precious. It's a commodity now that you know, it's almost as valuable as gold. Or it, for some people, it's as valuable as gold. How are we giving? How are we looking at the gifts that God has given us so we can give to others? I want to read you something from Colossians chapter 3, starting at verse 23. It says, whatever you do, do it heartily, as to the Lord and not to men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the reward of inheritance. For you serve the Lord. I'm going to say that again. For you serve the Lord. I want you to understand. It is good to work. It is good to make. It is good to save. But Wesley says you do all that so you can give it away. We do not serve the world. We do not work for our boss, even though, yes, he pays the bills, and yes, he does everything he's supposed to do him, but that's not our job. We do not go to school for my teachers. We do not go to school for my mom and dad. We go to school for the Lord. We work for the Lord. We live for the Lord. That who has given us life, you know, we talked about receiving every gift from him. That's who we serve. And we cannot begin to serve other things or other people or other situations or whatever. Yes, we live in this world and in this life. And we need to operate in this world and in this life. So do not hear me. Do not go tell your boss, my pastor said I cannot work here anymore and I don't work for you. Okay? Don't go tell him that. All right? What I'm saying is our attitudes have to change. As we begin to work for God, if we go to work and we're not working for the boss, and I'm not working for this guy or her guy or anything like that, but I'm working for the Lord, my job turns out better. Amen. Because when we work for God, when we work for the Lord, then we're striving a lot more because we're doing it for God. So we're not walking around kicking the cane going, no, we're actually wanting to be there. We're smiling. We're producing. We're doing all this stuff. And the boss is going, how can I get 16 of you? That's the attitude that we need to have in our life at all times. Our giving is not just when we reach into our pocket and give. Our giving is when we breathe, when we talk, how we see, how we interact, how we do things every day. That's our giving. We need to begin to change our attitude and know that when you walk into a store, before you buy anything, you have already given the gift of God. Because you bring Jesus with you. Right? And it's long line to get it to get something bought. It's not an obstacle, but an opportunity to show how gracious God is. We need to begin to change our understanding of what giving means, but also where giving comes from. And it comes from God. It comes from His gift to us. In 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7, it says, So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. We cannot operate our life because that's the way we're supposed to operate. We cannot give, we cannot show up just because, oh, the pastor has hounded me for a week and I'm going to show up. I'm glad that you showed up, but guess what? If you're not there because God called you, if you're not there to do what God calls you to do and give what God calls you to give, then go home. You've heard me say that before. If you're doing this because you have to, if you're doing it because you think this is what you're supposed to do, pack your bag and go to your house. We are here because God climbed down from that cross, walked out of the grave, gave us an opportunity to be better, to be different, to be saved by His grace, that in turn, we need to give that back to other people. I'm telling you, you have a wondrous gift inside of you that is your story. And you've heard me talk about that for 12 years. Your story is important to someone in this world, and you need to give them that present, that gift. They need to hear it. They need to know it. They need to glimpse into your life and see what God is doing, so in turn, they can change themselves into what God wants them to be through Jesus Christ. But we need to give. Don't keep it to yourself. Don't be stingy. You know, the fear of not being able to give something is because we fear we're not going to get it back. Okay, I get that. But guess what? God has more than we'll ever need. And He'll give you a match that you can never comprehend and give you everything, absolutely everything you need. I'm going to give you an example. Rebecca, years back, I mean, you guys remember, wanted to go to Africa, right? And she said, Daddy, I want to go to Africa. This is what it costs. And we're like, oh, okay. So we said, all right, well, we're going to pray. Yeah, the only way you're going to go is God wants you to go. She started selling t-shirts, right? Let me tell you something. God honored what we, the foundation of prayer and commitment to God and everything given to Him and asking for it. She not only paid for her trip, she paid for another team member's trip, and she had left over with enough the money at the people that she went to, and they had enough to support their village for a couple of months. That is the graciousness of God. She was having a fit. She went, Daddy, I have all this money. What am I going to do with all this money? Should I give it back? I'm like, no. Pay for them and pay for that and leave it over there. That's what it's for. She has such an abundance because, not because she's Rebecca or anything like that, because the foundation that we started on. We asked God into it. We told Him that we were going to honor Him, and this is what, if He wanted us to do this, this is what we're going to do. And God said, I got you. When I first started, before I even became a pastor, you know, everybody wanted me to go to Mexico with them to be a translator, right? And I told them, I said, look, I ain't got no money. I got a baby and I got a wife and I ain't got no, I'm a truck driver, I ain't got no money. I mean, whatever. And I said, if God wants me to go, I'll go. I mean, I'll go, but I mean, I ain't got no money. I went five times as a translator. Five times. I mean, paid totally. You know, you come and you say, okay, I need money. You call me back in a couple of days. I got your money. Let's go. If we have the attitude to do the things that God calls us to, when God calls us to do it, in the attitude that He wants us to do, guess what? He's going to do it. He's going to do it. I don't know why He chose me. I don't know why I was there. I don't know why I'm here. I don't know. But I do know this. God loves me. And He's faithful. And He's brought me here. And He's done these things for me to be able to have a story that I can tell somebody else. And when it comes a time to go, hey, Jose, what happened over here? Let me tell you what happened over here. And I went to this place in the middle of nowhere. And for 12 years, they loved on me. And they've helped me and they've grown me. And they were like, what? Yeah. Me. There's a reason. There's a why. And there's a how. And there's a because of Jesus. And He has the same thing for y'all. But we need to begin to move forward in that direction. We need to stop worrying about punching a clock and doing the things for the reasons that everybody does it. We live for the Lord. And the Lord lives for us. And when we begin to believe it, not just do it, guys, you need to believe it. Embrace it. Put it on you. Move forward. When you begin to do that, things will begin to change. And people begin to change. But we need to make that step. We need to move that forward. We need to give God's gift from where it's intended. From the heart and from joy. And when we give something, whatever it may be, whatever it is more important to you, that it is followed by joy in your heart and a smile on your face. Let me tell you something. It's not our responsibility what people do with the gift. I'm not responsible for that. I am only responsible to do what God calls me to do, and that is give the gift. And once I give the gift is gone. I don't have anything to do with it anymore. Now, they do what they do, done what they've done, they have to respond to God with that gift. I do not. We have to be people that once we give a gift, the gift is gone. It's done. Now, we can help you celebrate that gift, and we can help you use that gift. And, when you're talking about kids' toys, you're going to have to build that gift. I get that. But we are not attached to that gift anymore. We cannot tell them how to use the gift. How we think you should use a gift, or how you need to use a gift, that's not our responsibility. That's not our responsibility. You give, God says, give the gift. You give it, God bless you, you need me, I'll be right over here, see you later, alligator. And that's that. We're not attached to that gift anymore. God is attached to that gift. And He needs to deal with that as He deals with it. We need to give it. Smile as we're giving it. Feel good about what God has given us in our abundance so we can give it. And then move on. We cannot attach ourselves to the gift that is given and think that we're going to control it and have them use it like we want them to use it. That's not our responsibility. Our responsibility is to believe in that gift of God. That He has given it to us. That He will give it to us again so we can let it go. And that we need to have joy as we give. There is nothing better than seeing the joy in the gift. Let me tell you one last story. When I went to Mexico as a translator for one of those trips, the team was made up of medical personnel. Nurses, doctors, that kind of thing. It was kind of a medical thing. They wouldn't go and do that. All these are accomplished people, whatever, and there was me, whatever. And there was an older lady, and every time we met in the group, she always said, I don't know why I'm going. Right? She wasn't a nurse, she wasn't medical personnel, she wasn't anything. That was her thing. I don't know why I'm going, but God, I feel like God is calling me to go. I want to tell you, we were set up, right? Kids and families and everything was coming for the visits with the doctor. And that lady sat amongst the people in the waiting room. I don't know if we call it a waiting room, but it was a couple of chairs outside, you know, the waiting room. And she sat and doted after all those little children. I mean, when they were sitting there, she would hold them, she would play with them, she would kiss them, she would do all these things. And, you know, I don't know about y'all, y'all may know that when somebody else dotes over your children who you think are pretty special. But when somebody else does it, that makes you even feel even better. But the smiles and the joy in that waiting room were, I mean, I walked out, you know, of course, I got wrapped up in who, you know, what I was supposed to be doing. I walked out and they're laughing. And the ladies didn't speak English and she didn't speak Spanish. But they sure were having a good time laughing. When the gift comes from the heart and it is geared from what God has given you, then it will do tremendous things. And our giving needs to be from the heart, with joy, because it came from God's heart with joy. And when we can do that, when we can change our attitude and become that, trust me, your gift will go far. It will make a difference, and it will change things for eternity. All we have to do is take that step and give it. Amen? All right, we're going to close with 348, stand if you are able, and let us sing 1 of 4, 1 of 4, 348. Of our Lord Jesus Christ. May you believe, may you share, may you give in joy, that others may see his love in you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.